gospel has got an underscore pinpoint with laser precision. Verse number 28. The gospel of Matthew chapter 9. They went right into the house where he was staying. And Jesus asked them, "Do you believe I can make you see?" "Yes, Lord," they told him, "we do." Repeat these words after me. They went right into the house where he was staying. And Jesus asked them, "Do you believe I can make you see?" I want you to put a smile on your face. I want you to look at your neighbor. And I want you to say to your neighbor, "Oh neighbor, the battle to believe." Look across the room at somebody and smile at them now and say, "Neighbor, oh neighbor, I didn't come to bother you, didn't come to stir your Kool-Aid, but I want you to know I'm in a battle to believe." Wonderful God, in Jesus' name, we thank you now. As we prepare our hearts now for the teaching and preaching of your word, God, we pray that your spirit will guide us as your word goes forth in power and authority to accomplish that for which it was said. Wonderful God, I want to thank you right now for the greater one who lives within us. In your name, God, I pray that the Holy Ghost, who is the convictor, convincer, and persuader of truth, reveal the truth about the power and integrity of your word to every listener. And God, we pray right now that your words would be health to our bodies, strength to our hearts, renewal to our minds. We give you thanks, we give you honor, we give you praise in Jesus' name. And all of God's saints said, amen. The battle, God bless you, ushers. You may be seated. The battle to believe. Dr. Green, I don't know if you know it or not, but there's a battle going on in your life right now. And it is a battle between faith and unbelief. Bird, we're in a battle. You're in this battle because of impossible, unchanged circumstances. Yes, every time we turn around, it's always something. Mother Billingsley, we try to change our situation, but it seems as though we come up short. This battle will sometimes, Coach Floyd, get the best of you. Ms. Dallin, this battle will confuse you and frustrate you, Chief Orr. The battle will exhaust you of all your energy. This battle will cause you to lose sleep at night. This battle, C.T. Brown, brings on anxiety and stress. Ms. G, there is a battle going on in your life. There is a battle going on in your spirit. There's a battle going on in your heart. There is a battle going on in your mind. You might as well be honest about it, because if the truth be told, it's been kicking your behind for a few months now, and I know I'm right about it. There's a battle going on. There's a problem, Miss Jewel. There's a matter. There's a situation. There's a circumstance. There's a commitment. There's an illness. There's a trouble. There's a trial. There's a storm and a tribulation that is forcing you into a corner. Michelle, you've been trying to be faithful, but this thing in which you are dealing with is really getting the best of you. You're trying to do the right thing, but the right thing seems to exasperate the matter. You are caught between a rock wish I had a witness in here, in a hard place. Poor child, you tried to get rid of it, but every time you turn around, they're on the other end of your phone. Yes, you are in a battle, and the battle is to believe beyond your current impossible, unchanged position. Somebody listening to me right now, Miss Mary, is battling to believe that in spite of impossible, unchanged circumstances, they can make it. I want you to look at your neighbor, say neighbor or neighbor. In spite of impossible, unchanged circumstances, you can make it. That's right, that's right. Someone sitting here in the sanctuary is dealing with a matter, and it is not getting any better. In fact, it seems to be getting worse. You are in a battle to believe that in spite of what you are dealing with, everything will be all right. Look at your neighbor, Susan, and tell your neighbor, in spite of everything that you're dealing with, I believe everything will be all right. Our pericope, our selected portion of the sacred text for examination, is housed in the Gospel of Matthew. The Gospel of Matthew is the first book of the canonized Second Testament, known better to many of you as the New Testament. While it is unclear as to the author of the Gospel of Matthew, it is clear that the author desires to show Jesus as God's Messiah and also the fulfilling of the Old Testament. The author goes to great lengths, Miss Joanna, to craft a book that intimates, A, the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ as God's Messiah, B, the ministry of the Messiah, and C, the humiliation and exaltation of the Messiah. Our text for John today gives us two characters that had to battle to believe through their impossible, unchanged circumstances. The text indicates, Ms. G, that Jesus went on from there to resolve two incredibly impossible situations. I've got to pause right there and ask you to inform your worship partner that you can go on from here. I look at your neighbor right now and say, neighbor or neighbor, no matter what you're dealing with, you can go on from here. That's right, that's right, that's right. Many of us think that this is the end. Many of us think that there's no way out. But I'm delighted to inform you today that you can go on from here. It's my happy privilege to encourage you today. To encourage you that God has good plan for you. So go ahead and look at your neighbor, Dr. Tammy. Tell your neighbor, say, neighbor or neighbor, no matter what you're going through, God has good plan for you. The text indicates that two blind men followed Jesus, crying out to him from the top of their voices. The text indicates that the fact that they desired for Jesus to have mercy on them and address Jesus as the Son of David. Brother Arthur, the text indicates that Jesus entered an undisclosed location where the two unnamed men followed. The text indicates that Jesus inquired if they believed that he was able to do what they needed. The text indicates that our two blind brothers answered in the affirmative. Miss Angel, the text indicates that Jesus touched their eyes and said, according to your faith, Augustus, let it be done to you. Lieutenant, the text indicates that our two blind, unnamed brothers' eyes were open. The text indicates that Jesus sternly directed them, Miss Walker, not to tell anybody. But the text tells us that they were unable to follow that directive. My job is to ask where God is in the text. my theological response is that God is able, in spite of impossible, unchanged circumstances, to deliver what we need to those of us who have the courage to win the battle. Look at your neighbor, say, neighbor or neighbor, do you have the courage to win the battle? Beloved, never allow impossible, unchanged circumstances to persuade you that you have no need to believe. When we fail to believe, we have lost. Battle to believe, beloved, and discover that God is able to deliver in real time that which you stand in need of. Now I invite you to come and sit with me as I attempt to share with you the prophetic truths of the text as I see them. Are y'all ready to get on the train? Let's board, let's go. When we are battling to believe, we must first of all walk in faith. Look at your neighbor, say, neighbor or neighbor, walk in faith. Look at the text, look at the text. In verse 27, it reads, two blind men followed him. The text informs the reader that two blind men followed Jesus. One must stop and ask the critical question, how can blind persons follow when blind persons can't see? Do I have a witness in here? While some would suggest that they were following noise, our author does not give the reader a crowd with Jesus. No, ma'am, no, sir. The author gives the reader two blind men and one Jesus. Susan, it's my pleasure to argue that the text tells us that when we are faced with impossible, unchanged circumstances, that we are to walk believing. Look at your neighbor, say, neighbor or neighbor, your job is to walk believing. Do I have a witness in here? The New Testament writer teaches us that we are to walk by faith and not by sight. Our author has these two men walking and believing that Jesus can fix it. And so many times in our lives, we give out while attempting to believe. Chief, or we give in while attempting to believe. Chief, or we quit while attempting to believe. Chief, or we shut down while attempting to believe. But Dr. Green, these two men who are blind walked in faith. They walked to believe. Somebody say, I'm walking to believe. Somebody in this race, I need to encourage you today to keep walking. I need to encourage you today to keep running. I need to encourage you today to keep shouting. I need to encourage you today to keep praising. I need to encourage you faith. Oh, do I have a witness in here? Look at the text in verse 28b. Do you believe that I'm able to do this? It says, beloved, Jesus acknowledged that they were walking in faith. Now Jesus then proceeds to probe their faith. Jesus asked them if they believed that he was able to deliver their need. Why would Jesus probe their faith if they were walking in faith? I suggest that just because you're walking in faith does not mean that you have a deep and sincere love of God Jesus. Do you hear me today? Do you want it? And do you mean it? Jesus wanted to know how bad they wanted it. Please hear me today. Jesus is not ignoring you. Jesus is not hitting the decline button when he sees your name on his iPhone. Jesus is probing your faith. Do I have a witness in here? Baby, your faith is being investigated. Look at your neighbor right now and say, neighbor, oh neighbor, my faith is being investigated. That's right, beloved. That's right, that's right. That's right, Miss Patsy. Jesus is investigating our faith to see if it's worthy of our request. When Jesus investigates your faith, will Jesus find any sincerity? Will Jesus find any praise? Will Jesus find any sacrifice? Will Jesus find any service? Will Jesus find any works? Will Jesus find any usefulness? Do I have a witness here? Will Jesus find any substance in your faith? Beloved, how bad do you want it today? How bad do you want to be saved? How bad do you want to be delivered? I heard the ancestors say, search me, Lord. Come on and search me, Lord. Come on and turn the light from heaven. Oh, my soul, if you find anything that shouldn't be, take it out and straighten me. I want to be right. I want to be saved. I want to be whole. Look at your neighbor. Say, neighbor, I want God to investigate my faith. I want God to search me. I want God to take a close look at my faith to see if I'm worthy of what I'm asking. And after your faith is investigated, then I need you to answer in faith. Look at your neighbor. Say, neighbor, oh neighbor, it's time to answer in faith. Do I have a witness in here? Susan, if you don't mind, look at the text in verse 28c. They said to him, this is what it says, Susan. They said to him, yes, Lord. I need for somebody to open up their mouth right now and say, yes, Lord. Say it again, yes, Lord. Jesus inquires, beloved, and they answer in faith by saying, yes, Lord. This is a very vital, this is a very important piece today, because the writer never gives us a direct request. Do you hear what I'm saying? Do a close to bless me. It'll be all right. So, chief Lord, the text says that we should walk in faith. The text says that God will investigate our faith. The text suggests that we are then to answer in faith. Versus the Tammy, help me, Holy Ghost. The text suggests that when we answer in faith, that God will reward our faith. Look at your neighbor and say, neighbor, God will reward your faith. Susan, if you will, look at verse 29. It says, Jesus touched their eyes and said, according to your faith, according to your loyalty, let it be done to you. And C.T. Brown, yes, I drove in to work today.